Good morning, everybody. Welcome to today's 1 million by 1 million strategy roundtable. 1M1M, as you know, is the first global virtual accelerator in the world. We operated out of Silicon Valley, but with a global footprint. We work with entrepreneurs all over the world. And our mission is to help a million entrepreneurs reach $1 million and beyond in annual revenue. In support of that mission, we do these free roundtables pretty much every week on Thursday mornings. And, you know, the formats, usually we have a guest, we have entrepreneurs pitching, and sometimes I do some special material coverage, which I'm going to do some of today. So I'll tell you more about that later. This is our 314th roundtable. You know, we've been obviously doing it for many, many years now. The first one was back in 2008, the fall of 2008. And that was an experiment which really made us think, and everything else kind of followed from that organic experiment with this format of doing roundtable mentoring sessions, or online roundtable mentoring sessions. This event is being recorded. I know many of you follow us on the YouTube channel and access these roundtables on YouTube. You'll have that available later. And if you're following us on Twitter, please use hashtag 1M1M for live tweeting today's show. And otherwise, we are at 1M by 1M and at Romana. And we do publish a lot of rich content on an ongoing basis. The YouTube channel, by the way, is 1M1M Roundtables. You'll find all prior recordings of these roundtables over there. These are the call-in instructions. So we do encourage you to call in and chat and ask questions and so forth. So this is one way of engaging with the roundtable. This is a roundtable. It's not a broadcast. It's a roundtable. So we want you to participate. And then you can also use the public chat and send to all participants. I know there are a lot of people already in the room and people are trickling in. Feel free to introduce yourselves, tell us where you're joining from, who you are, what project you're working on, and so forth. So this is also an opportunity for networking. We're going to start with a conversation with Arjun Dev Arora, founder of ReTargeter, and he's currently involved in 500 startups as a venture partner. So we're going to talk about a variety of different topics on that front. So Arjun, welcome first and foremost. It's great to have you. It's been a while. We haven't talked in quite a while, actually.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Here. So, you know, your LinkedIn says, Arjun was the founding CEO of ReTargeter and bootstrapped the company to be in the top 100 of Inc.'s fastest growing companies list in 2013. When we first met, you had already bootstrapped ReTargeter to $5 million plus in revenue, if I recall correctly, and that was a while ago. Tell us about ReTargeter. How did you do it?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, started the company in 2009, and the goal was really to democratize retargeting technology. So it was a technology that had been around for quite a number of years, but was really limited to Fortune maybe 100 companies and limited in scope to you know, basically organizations and publishers that were one small subsegment of the internet. So you could only retarget users on a very small handful of sites. So our goal was to basically democratize the technology, increase the places where it could be, where ads could be seen for our customers, and then also by using technology, make it really, really easy for even, you know, smaller businesses to be able to get started and start using retargeting. So, you know, I think we got started, and our core focus was really on this vision and on this mission of making this, you know, kind of amazing targeting technology accessible to folks, and that's what drove us. And I think initially, we really kind of hacked together the first version, was kind of a stitching various open source solutions, but that allowed us to get started. And I think with that, we started to, you know, slowly build our customer base and continue to grow from there. But that was kind of the genesis of the company. And in terms of bootstrapping, I think the core focus was finding a sustainable revenue model that really worked for us. And so we were able to create kind of a new model in the advertising technology space, which was more subscription-driven versus IO-driven. And then we worked really, really to change people's perspectives around the fact that retargeting should be a line item, not something you test once or just do around Christmas time or, do once and then don't do again. But we really did a lot of effort, energy in terms of making this in terms of marketing, in terms of making something that folks thought about as something they always have on their marketing budget. And so that I think helped us build a company where we could start to, work hard to get these customers and then ultimately have them stay with us. And then that started to build kind of a sustainable revenue trajectory, which and kind of consistent SaaS revenue, which then helped us be able to bootstrap.
And was there a particular customer segment, where you found your early traction? And how did you identify that segment?
Yeah, if I'm being, completely honest, I think the first segment that we found a lot of traction with was my first degree network and my second degree network. And then I think there we started to figure out kind of what are the places where, we might see some resonance. What are the verticals where we might see some, resonance? So initially, I think we probably got somewhere to 50, maybe even close to 75 customers with just kind of through the network and people we knew. So it ended up being a lot of, San Francisco, Silicon Valley technology companies, tended to be some folks in the space. My brother started a company in that world. And then over time, we started to get more, consistency. But over time, I think we realized that it was retail, so kind of high-end retail products that weren't just a single CD online, but rather maybe a expensive handbag or, more kind of high-end good on retail. Then we did a lot of B2B SaaS, and we had a lot of customers that were software providers themselves. And so, retargeting for that particular use case was very powerful. Over time, 3, 4, 5 years later, we started to work with advertising agencies, which is a whole other story, but from there we started working with traditional CPG type customers and big folks like Verizon. But I'd say initially out the gate it was high-end retail and B2B SaaS where we found our first kind of maybe couple million dollars in revenue. There were of course other verticals, but those were the big ones.
And what were you charging in terms of your SaaS pricing model? What were these 50 to 75 customers that you initially got to? What were they paying?
Yeah, they were paying typically $500 a month, anywhere from $500 to probably $1,500 a month was what they were paying. And that was basically based off the number of unique users that they had. So if it was a relatively small site, it was $500 a month. If it was larger, it started, started to scale up linearly. In the early days, most of our customers were quite small, and hence the kind of lower price point. Over time, I remember one customer that I think was $80,000 a month that was much, much larger. But when we started, it was most of our early customers were $500 to $1,000 a month.
Mm-hmm. People in the audience, this number, somewhere in that 50 to 100 customer number for, especially for SaaS companies, a very important number. And we kind of, in our methodology, we want you to talk to 50 to 100 customers even before you have actually built your MVP, just so that you can really understand what they're looking for and both build those relationships early as well as learn from them what is it that those customers are looking for so that you can fold that into your specs. And I think you're hearing an echo of that in Arjun's story. So Arjun, it's been a while. 2009 is when you started ReTargeter. Now, the online advertising industry has evolved quite a lot in that time frame. Could you kind of summarize the key trends that you see? Who are the winners? Who are the losers? And what are the trends that are winning? What are the trends that are losing? Where are the opportunities in ad tech today as we sit in 2016?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, it's been quite a ride. I think one of the things that's very unique about advertising technology and marketing technology in particular is that it is one of the most dynamic, kind of fast-moving spaces. I think maybe gaming is the only other one that I can think of that has a similar sort of velocity to it. But I'll walk through maybe starting around 2007, 2008, we saw a lot of inventory was still being bought through advertising exchanges. So a lot of display inventory was bought through ad exchanges, and it was done in a pretty manual process. You talk with your person at the ad exchange, and maybe you could do it through a web-based interface, but it was only limited to a small subsegment of the inventory that was available online. And so you'd maybe partner with a Right Media or a DoubleClick or maybe AOL's ad exchange, and you get access to inventory that you needed. And the targeting at that time was really limited to publisher-based targeting. So it was maybe some categories of inventory, but it was mostly, here are the types of publishers. This is a food blog. This is a news site, those sort of things. Then kind of came around the advent of the DSP, or the demand side provider, and the DSP basically created a middleware layer that sat in between all of the ad networks and ad exchanges down below, and then this was kind of here, and then above that was where the advertisers or partners, such as ourselves, ReTargeter, sat. The DSPs basically enabled people to buy inventory across a vast majority of ad networks and ad exchanges with one seat or with one login. So some of the big companies in that space that have done very well include AppNexus, MediaMath, The Trade Desk, even Centro in some ways is now a bit of a DSP. So these are the folks that realized that there were way too many ad networks and ad exchanges and that really needed to be able to create a layer that allowed the person to be able to access all that inventory. So with that also came kind of the rise of the programmatic data buying is kind of what it's known as today. And that's the ability to buy ad impressions, one ad impression at a time across a variety of different ad networks and ad exchanges, and then doing things like understanding frequency caps or, I only want to buy X number of ads against a particular user, or I want to buy, a million impressions in the next hour and then I'm done. So you can do some really interesting things with kind of the rise of the DSPs. ReTargeter was kind of sat on top of that layer of DSPs, a couple of them, and that enabled us to buy inventory on behalf of our clients, and we added kind of a retargeting layer to enable us to retarget folks. So that's kind of the trajectory of the display ecosystem. I'd say we're kind of in the middle of the DSP programmatic ad buying world right now. I think now we've moved to a place where I think the majority of ad impressions are now finally bought programmatically, which is an exciting time. And I think pretty soon we'll get to a super majority where 60, 70, 80% of ad impressions are bought programmatically, and not picking up the phone and calling your rep at the Wall Street Journal or New York Times and saying, "Hey, I'd like to buy $50,000 worth of display inventory on the front page of the New York Times, and I want to run this in 2 months." Rather, you can just kind of jump online, punch in a few things, and buy your inventory as needed. So there'll always be very premium inventory that will only be available to folks, directly. But in the interim, there's going to be a lot that's going to happen, programmatically. So that's kind of where display has gone and shifted. And mobile and video have all been a part of that transition. I think, display. When I say display, I'm including kind of mobile and video, and they've gone through similar transitions. There's companies in the mobile space. Started off as Millennial Media. That was kind of more the ad networky, ad exchangey model. Now there's some wonderful companies like Pocket Math and others in the mobile space. And then in video, there's companies like TubeMogul and BrightRoll and Yumi and others that are more programmatic in nature for video. So we've seen a lot of that transition happen. Similarly with social, particularly on top of the Facebook ecosystem, there's been a handful of companies like Spruce Media and AdParlor and others that built themselves on top of the social kind of fray. So now I think that the next major trends that we're going to see, one that I'm particularly excited about, that is maybe I'd say a little bit more forward-reaching as what happens with AR and advertising. So I think there's going to be some really interesting stuff there. I think we're in the middle of some trends around really deep data for social. Mm-hmm. So there's cool companies like Affin.io, ASFIN.io, which basically allows you to do a very in-depth analysis of the Twitter stream and niches and tribes of Twitter followers and be able to, you know, target or retarget them appropriately. So that one's actually really, you know, really exciting on kind of the data-driven advertising approach. And then, I think, like I said, if we're thinking, you know, 5 years out, I think there's some really interesting stuff happening with AR, VR in terms of what advertising is going to look like in that environment, in that channel as well.
So I have a couple of questions kind of double-clicking on what you said. In the display advertising world, given the trends that you're describing, there's an inordinate advantage that Facebook is sitting with, right? The amount of personalization data they have available is orders of magnitude higher than anybody else. What does that do to the industry?
Yeah, I think it's already shifted the industry pretty dramatically. I think when the Facebook exchange opened up, now it's been a few years, but it was a big shift in the industry. I think a lot of inventory started just moving there because that's where the users were, that's where people were. And in the past, you would have to buy that like a traditional publisher. So akin to kind of how you would buy inventory in 2005 and 2006 in terms of the kind of traditional web, was how people were buying inventory on Facebook prior to the beginning of the Facebook exchange. But Facebook moved very quickly, created a Facebook exchange, allowed people to buy inventory programmatically, allowed people to retarget inventory, buy inventory based off of other, you know, cookies and data sets. So very quickly, in short order, in about a year, remember kind of that shift happened fast. This again speaks to the dynamic nature of the ad industry. Facebook really took off, and I think it was interesting to see how quickly, that happened. So, that's been an exciting trend to watch. And I think to date they still have the majority of, they have a lot of mindshare in kind of the display ecosystem. I'm curious to see kind of how some of these new platforms that are just now growing and starting, like Snapchat, will ultimately impact that, because that's where people are spending more time and attention. So it'll be interesting, although Snapchat doesn't have anywhere near the level and the depth of data that Facebook does.
Yeah. Well, and I think it puts a lot of the, older style media companies in great disadvantage, right? What happens to those? Personally, actually, several media sites, massive sites, 100 million visitors, who are unable to monetize and what will happen to these sites? Are they going to go out of business? And how do they strategize given this, if an advertiser has an option in advertising in a highly targeted fashion on Facebook, why would they want to advertise in one of these content sites?
Right. So, yeah, it's interesting. I think what's happening is a couple of different pieces that are happening there. Either audiences are becoming very so publishers are basically driving audiences that are very niche, where they can command very high CPMs. So, people in Tulsa who are very interested in Teslas, for example, might be a very niche audience that people can target. And if that happens, then you can still command a pretty high CPM and build a business that's sustainable, although it gets much harder to be massive when it's so niche. So I think we're seeing the nicheification of certain publishers, and if the audience is interested enough, they can even start to charge a small subscription to get access to that content. I think we've seen a lot more subscription-based media that's been popping up, even if it's 99 cents a month. With enough of a reader base, it actually it can create a sustainable business. So that ends up working. One of the ideas that's more on the fringes is this idea that people can actually tip or have like a tipping system or a Bitcoin-enabled, per views reading system. So we've seen some things in and around the space. It's still very early, but that may end up being a model that that works. So I think it'll be interesting to see if that's a model that actually sticks. But the principle there is that, maybe you have $10 a month that you are putting towards supporting journalists. And as you're reading articles that really resonate, you can tip, small amount, and maybe that helps to sustain the ecosystem. I think it's a massive user behavior change, so I don't know if we'll actually see that that occur.
I don't see that happening. I see the thing that concerns me tremendously about the web is that we're becoming more and more of a free rider society. Everybody thinks everything on the internet should be free, especially consumer behavior, and that is, you know, it's not sustainable in the long run. That's not sustainable.
Yeah. I think what happens then is that advertising gets more and more aggressive, which is not good for the users at all. So I think happened already with massive kind of rising star ad units that come down across half the page, and it's because the publishers need to make money and the advertisers need to make sure there's no banner blindness and ad blockers don't work and all these kind of things. So we're seeing really interesting custom units that are trying to solve that problem. But yeah, you're absolutely right. It's going to be someone's going to have to come up with another model that will allow publishers to build sustainable models, or else it's a problem.
So what percentage of digital ads today are retargeted? I see more and more ads following me around. You know, as a consumer, I see this stuff following me around all the time. So what are the key trends in the retargeting industry?
Yeah, so I was looking at some more recent data. It's interesting. Just across the Facebook ecosystem as well for retargeting, it's actually only 0.5% of the total ad impressions were actually retargeting, but it actually drove 15 clicks. So that's probably a relatively appropriate proxy to use for retargeting as a whole. The power of retargeting, of course, is that you're only showing ads to people who have visited your site, and you're only engaging with the people that are actively engaged. And so you don't have to buy as many ad impressions. You don't have to buy out the entire New York Times to be able to get access to a handful of people that fit your demographic, but rather you can target them directly. So it is still a smaller portion of the overall impression base, but the kind of outsized performance is what makes it really interesting.
And last question on the advertising topic, and then we'll switch to something else. If an entrepreneur came to you today and said that she wants to build a business based on the advertising business model, what advice would you give her?
Probably don't do it. There's if you're doing something built in marketing technology, if you're building a SaaS platform to help marketers communicate with influencers or manage their social media better or understand and leverage these new kind of AR, VR technologies for advertising, I think that's interesting. I think if you're building a traditional kind of ad tech play, maybe you're reselling mobile or video or display, I would probably say, it's not worth it. There are other better ways to spend your time and build this massive business. Now, if you're building an agency, that's different. If you're building an advertising agency, helping people, buy ads across all these different platforms, then that's a different story. I think if you're trying to build a business that can really scale and have some meaningful growth potential in a short period of time, then I would heavily caution against advertising technology.
So switching gears, you're now at 500 startups, and you're seeing a lot of new companies. You're thinking about what should be, what are the new trends, and where are the opportunities in early stage startups. What is your synthesis of where we are? Where do you see, good possibilities of building significant companies?
Totally. Yeah, so it's an exciting time to say the least. I think there's still a lot of industries that are ripe for kind of disruption and disintermediation with really thoughtful design and technology. So some of the spaces that in the more recent past, I'd say in the last several months that have come up, insurance tech and fintech in general is definitely a very hot space. I've seen a lot in that world. I think HR tech is still fascinating. I think building software to help managers and leaders just be better at their job to create a better work environment is something that I'm personally passionate about. Things around the future of work, things just in this kind of same vein, but just things around benefits or portable benefits for 1099 contractors or for non-W-2 employees, with rise of more and more people who are working as contractors. So there's a lot of software technology to be built around that, both from the business side and also from the kind of customer or the employee side, so to speak. So there's some interesting things there. I think for those who have a 5 to 10 year time horizon, AR and VR are particularly exciting. So I think there's definitely some interesting things there. Along the trend of freelancers and contractors, there's just a lot of options around what does it look like? What is the future of WeWork? So we saw WeWork galvanize these sort of co-working spaces in large cities, but we're starting to see some really interesting companies that are taking that even further. So what does it look like when it doesn't even have to be an office space, but can be a mansion by the California coast instead of a corporate office building? So there's some interesting things happening in that regard as well. And I'm still very passionate about kind of marketing tech and sales tech as well. And then on the consumer side, I think we've seen the big trend of the Uberification of everything. I think that'll continue with a bit more reservation now, so it won't be as crazy as it was, let's say, 2 or 3 years ago, but there's still a lot of things that can be done on demand or even subscribed to in meaningful ways. So while HomeJoy didn't really work when it comes to getting a cleaning service on demand, there will be, and I know of a handful of companies that are now solving that problem in more of a, hey, let's get a more regular schedule in place and put some more structure behind it. So there's some things that I think were on demand in the past wave that now people are realizing maybe don't need to be on demand, but there's still big businesses there. So that's interesting. And the last thing I'll mention is just industrial. So a lot happening in shipping, logistics, trucking, which I'm actually very excited about. I think these unsexy industries are going to be massive. There's a company called Flexport, which is awesome. PlanGrid, which is working on construction software for the construction space. So all of these kind of more traditional industries that are finally getting around to leveraging software in a meaningful way are super exciting as well.
Yeah, and that's summarized as vertical cloud, and there's a lot of vertical cloud activity. So what I'm hearing in terms of business models is your preference is for SaaS business models, and you're not particularly crazy about ad tech, advertising as a business model. Ad tech SaaS is okay, but not advertising so much. And what about e-commerce? What's your read on e-commerce?
Yeah, e-commerce is, I mean, super exciting. I think there's a lot of opportunities there. It's looking at Dollar Shave Club, Combatant Gentleman. There's a handful of really interesting, innovative companies that are being built, Warby Parker, that are being built back to the roots, and so many of them that are being built in kind of this new technology enhanced and enabled, basically e-commerce truly built in the technology era, not kind of tacked on later, and doing really smart things on the marketing side with technology as well. So, I'm excited about the space. I think it is just much harder now to raise capital for that sort of a business. So I think it's a business that you have to be comfortable bootstrapping for quite a while so you can get to 10, 20, even $40 million of revenue. Not necessarily purely bootstrapping, but it's much harder to raise venture funding for this sort of an e-commerce business. But still massive opportunities. I spoke with a company recently.
The good news, though, is that e-commerce is very bootstrappable because you don't need a whole lot of investment to get money flowing, and then once you have a little bit of track record established, you can get inventory financing. There are all kinds of companies like On Deck, Cabbage. These guys all give inventory financing, and very, very quickly based on your transaction history. So that type of company is actually much, much easier to bootstrap.
Absolutely, and I think that's what makes it exciting. And there's companies that you see out there that are building beautiful products, and they're able to get them out in the world very quickly. But no, that's a wonderful point.
Any other thoughts? Closing thoughts?
It's an exciting time to be an entrepreneur. So I think there's a lot more. There's a lot less to be done. There's a lot of things that there's a lot of ways to as an entrepreneur to do things that make things better for humanity or for workers or for just people in general. And so I think it's an exciting time to to be involved in the ecosystem. So I highly encourage people
to... Are you getting back in? Are you going to start another company soon?
Maybe. I think right now I'm enjoying being on the venture side and getting to work with really passionate, awesome entrepreneurs at 500 startups. So I'm enjoying my time now. But, once you kind of do it, it's hard to stop. So we'll see.
Yeah. All right. Thank you for coming, Arjun. Good luck. And we'll be in touch.
Really appreciate it. Yep. Talk soon. Have a good one. Bye.
Bye-bye. Folks, we're going to spend the next 45 minutes or so discussing something that I think you all need to pay attention to. And this discussion is based on a talk that I gave recently at Berkeley. And the topic is billion-dollar unicorns, myths, and realities. The reason I think it's important at this juncture to hear about what is real in this whole unicorn storyline and what are the myths and what are the falsehoods in this whole sector is something that is becoming quite clear. So it's not as much of a voodoo. There is actually quite significant storylines and trends and observations that we are coming up with that I have synthesized and I will take you through. So all of you who are thinking of building billion-dollar unicorn companies, I would like you to take this set of points into account in your decision-making process. So just to level set, definition-wise, a unicorn, as it has been defined over the last few years, is it's a billion-dollar market cap company, not revenue, but market cap. They used to be very rare, by the way. They used to be less than five a year. Now, in the last couple of years, VCs went crazy, and in 2015 particularly, 78 companies were valued at billion-dollar market cap levels, and largely private. So there were so many venture funding rounds that valued private companies at billion-dollar levels. So this is an odd phenomenon, right? It used to be less than five. In 2015, everything kind of went crazy. 78, that's a way, out of line escalation in the number of unicorns. It's just not reasonable. There were 221 100 million plus financing rounds. $100 million, you raise $100 million, that's a huge amount of money. And you have to get a real valuation, an exit valuation, at a very serious number to be able to give returns to investors as well as make money yourself if you have that kind of money in the company. So it's a very, you're setting the bar for yourself so high, and the chances of failure, our probability of failure is going up very significantly the minute you accept a $100 million plus financing round. And yet, 221 companies accepted to raise 100 million plus financing rounds, and VCs invested in 221 companies with more than $100 million each. It's an anomaly for sure, and it's kind of a scary anomaly. In 2016, market has started rationalizing. You hear a lot about, the unicorn implosion phenomenon. If you follow our blog, we've been covering this series called From Unicorn to Unicorps, which is our way of covering this implosion. And the number of $100 million financing rounds are much fewer this year. The question is, what happened? You have to look at a core feature of these unicorns. There are real unicorns, and then there are pseudo-unicorns. Real unicorns are $100 million plus annual revenue run rate companies. Strong growth rate, 10x revenue multiple in terms of valuation, profitable unit economics, and they get $1 billion valuation. This is a legitimate valuation. The pseudo unicorns are unicorns that have the valuation but do not have the revenue. So the real unicorns can sustain. The pseudo unicorns are dependent on luck, kind of, maybe a chance event where an acquisition or an exit happens, where they can get somebody to pay a lot of money. Like Marissa Mayer has, you know, spent a lot of money buying Tumblr at a unicorn valuation. Tumblr is a pseudo unicorn. That's not something that anybody should be buying. But Marissa did, and you can see the state of Yahoo now. So, but Tumblr managed to get out, right? So in that case, the investors and the entrepreneurs all ended up making a lot of money. Yahoo ended up sitting there basically with this asset that doesn't monetize and doesn't give them anything, but they spent a lot of money on it. So this is the kind of unicorn that is very, very risky, and most of them will implode. So I have a cartoon for you. You may have seen it floating around. So we, in our work, in these roundtables, we talk to a lot of entrepreneurs. And this comic strip is based on one of those interactions. An entrepreneur comes to me and says, my business will shift the paradigm. And I ask them, what is your business model? And the answer is to get acquired by Google. And my question in that context is, do you know what the difference between a business model and an exit strategy? And the bewildered entrepreneur's reaction is, what's the difference? So the problem with the real unicorns versus pseudo-unicorn phenomenon is that the real unicorns have a business model. The pseudo-unicorns just have an exit strategy. They don't have a business model. And my take on a lot of these valuation without revenue unicorns who have traditionally said, oh, let's just build up a lot of traffic and then we will figure out how to monetize, or we'll advertise, we'll raise, we'll monetize with advertising, it doesn't work. Advertising business model doesn't work very well, not anymore. And this we'll figure out later, business model strategy also does not work. I'm going to talk about a few real unicorns that I really, really respect and admire. One of them, my favorite, is Tableau Software. The company was founded in January 2003. It bootstrapped to 100 customers, not a penny of outside financing. The founders actually did a company before that, which they basically built something really small and exit in 18 months. And got a little bit of money, not a lot of money, but enough such that they could bootstrap Tableau to 100 customers. They raised their Series A financing from NEA at a $20 million pre-money valuation with real revenue, and they had an OEM deal with Hyperion Software. So, you know, the company was well validated. 100 customers is a lot of validation, right? There's 50 to 100 customers in most B2B software companies is an excellent place to be in. And, you know, at that time, I would say probably average Series A valuations were $5 million. And these guys got $20 million pre-money valuation. Their revenue in 2004 was $800,000. 2009 was $20 million. That's because they also had this Hyperion OEM deal, which, you know, really gave them a big hockey stick. They IPO'd in 2013 at a $2 billion market cap. 2013 revenue was $81.5 million. 2016 market cap is $3.5 billion. So this is a very capital-efficient execution. The company actually, for most of its execution history, pre-IPO execution history, raised only about $11 million in financing. I think there is a mezzanine round right before the IPO, but in terms of actually building the company, I think they only used about $11 million. So turning $11 million of investment into $3.5 billion market cap, to me, this is an incredibly great story. And the founders made incredible amounts of money. And I'll tell you one thing I'm very biased towards is that I don't like this idea of, you know, building companies and founders not making money. We are, you know, in 1 million by 1 million, we are very much on the founder's side. So we want you to make money no matter what. So let's contrast Tableau's story with a pseudo-unicorn, Guild Group, raised $286 million, and then it was acquired for $250 million. Founded in 2007, acquired in 2015, founders made no money at all after 8 years of work. They got a lot of publicity. This is a very high-profile company. Guild Group is a very high-profile company. But, you know, none of the entrepreneurs made any money, and the investors didn't make much money either. So let's do a thought experiment. You want to be a unicorn company? Let's call your company X, founded in 2012, 2015 revenue, $5 million annual revenue run rate. Let's say it's a SaaS company. You got a term sheet in 2015, $50 million raised at a $1 billion valuation. That makes the company a unicorn. However, there's a 3X liquidation preference. VCs have to be paid $150 million before anyone else makes any money. You raise $50 million, 3X liquidation preference, you've got to return $150 million before anyone else makes any money. 2017 revenue, $20 million. Get an acquisition offer, acquisition price, $120 million. A good, decent 10X on revenue market cap. Or valuation, exit valuation. But $120 million still doesn't cover the liquidation preference. The founders make no money after 5 years of work. This is the kind of unicorn that you should not be. I don't want you to be this kind of a unicorn. You don't need to raise that much money. You don't need to get the media coverage of being an entrepreneur, of being a unicorn entrepreneur. What you need to decide is what is the path that you want to take that is going to create some personal wealth for you, give healthy returns to your investors. So you should consider what kind of an entrepreneur do you want to be and have a very clear roadmap of success. You must have heard me say this before. Entrepreneurship equals customers, revenues, and profits. Financing and exit are optional. Here's another comic strip for you. Who makes more money? Here's Jim and Sarah conversing at a cafe. Hey, Jim, what have you been up to? Hi, Sarah, I just sold my business. It took me 5 years to build it. What a coincidence. I, too, just sold my business. Since lots of great investors funded me, I ended up owning 5% in the end. We sold it for a whopping $100 million, so I now have $5 million in the bank. I sold mine for just $25 million, but I didn't have any investors. Come to think of it, I'm glad I didn't. I have $25 million in the bank now. And now Jim wakes up, no kidding. He realizes that he has, you know, spent 5 years, Sarah has also spent 5 years, and in the end, there is a much better outcome. So also remember, criteria for VC financing is hyper-fast growth rate and super large TAM. The probability of your company, your business, hitting these two primary requirements of venture funding, venture-style companies is very low. Because companies typically don't grow at this exponential pace, and companies typically do not have these multi-billion dollar TAM. Billion dollar TAM is very rare. There are many more 5 million, 10 million, 20 million, 50 million dollar ideas. And they're perfectly fine ideas, perfectly fine niche business opportunities to build. Over 99% of the entrepreneurs get rejected by VCs. Mark Andreessen made this famous quote, it is our job to reject. You know, this is what they do. You know, if you look at the rejection statistics of major VCs, Y Combinator, all these guys. In fact, there's a post, if you're interested in actually looking at some of these numbers, go look at this post on rejection, called Rejection Statistics of Key Players on our blog, and I have actually summarized a lot of these numbers. Our mantra is bootstrap first, raise money later, if at all. So it's okay if you bootstrap to a certain level of validation and you can legitimately say that, yes, this company is going to grow really fast, this company is going to scale to, you know, $100 million in 5-6 years, then it's okay to raise money. But if it's not, if you're going to build a $20 million company in 5 years, you're better off bootstrapping that company and using alternative financing as opposed to venture financing such that you don't give, you know, basically all your ownership away and then end up in a place where there's no exit. So there is a twilight zone of venture-funded startups that don't grow fast, have taken a lot of money, and cannot find exits. You're kind of stuck. You can't get divorced from your VC. There's also a myth that unicorns cannot be bootstrapped. This is a lie. Zoho, eClinical Works, Veeam, each of these are 300 million plus revenue companies. And they, each of those three are completely bootstrapped. Right now, Tableau, ServiceNow, these are also unicorns. They were bootstrapped first and they raised money later. So, yes, unicorns can be bootstrapped. In fact, good unicorns are mostly bootstrapped first, raise money later kinds of model companies. One of my heroes on this topic is Linda Weinman. Linda bootstrapped to significant revenue, lynda.com, and then raised for private equity funding, sold to LinkedIn for $1.5 billion. This is a real unicorn, had a lot of revenue, almost $100 million of revenue when LinkedIn bought lynda.com. So, you know, and this was a company that was built over 20 years. So most of the history of this company was a history of a bootstrap journey of Linda Weinman. I also love the story of Pavin Parik of Magush. We've had him as a guest at our roundtables. Pavin is doing a test prep company from Berkeley, California. The only money he has raised is $750,000 in angel financing, equity financing, and he's bootstrapped to over $5 million in revenue. Excellent, excellent execution, really capital efficient. And he has a lot of options. You know, the more time goes by, the more they execute well, the more options open up. Venki Balasubramaniam of Plevo, very interesting also. It's a voice API company. This company actually, the only financing it has is $2 million in two tranches of convertible notes. It has not given up any equity almost. And they're bootstrapped to over $15 million in revenue with that $2 million in convertible note financing. So these are incredibly good cap tables. You know, these entrepreneurs have a lot of choices, and they will be successful. They will create personal wealth. And they're already solving customer problems because customers are paying them. That's why they're able to generate the kind of revenue they're generating, and they're very profitable companies. So these companies will be successful no matter what. Some of the unicorns, the huge unicorns, are not going to be successful. But these companies, these capital-efficient companies, are going to be successful. There's also another myth, you have to quit your job to start a company. This is not true. We have done case study after case study of bootstrapping with a paycheck. And Girish Navani, who has been at our roundtables, we have case studies on eClinical Works, Girish's company. So you can really dig deep into the story of Girish Navani in the 1M1M forum. He built eClinical Works bootstrapped with a paycheck. So, you know, you can build that. That company now is over $300 million in revenue with no outside financing at all. So very powerful story, and and this bootstrapping with a paycheck actually works very well. I have written a book on this topic, so it's something that you can also look up, and we have a full module in the 1M1M curriculum on bootstrapping with a paycheck. The other myth is services companies are not interesting. Well, again, false. Bootstrapping product companies using services works great. Oracle was built this way, and numerous other software companies have been built in this mode. It's very, very actually helpful to go work with customers in the same domain in which you're going to be building the product, and you work in a service mode where people are giving you their problems, people are giving you their specs of what they need, and you need to essentially negotiate IP so that you can build a product and preserve the IP, and then you can go from there. It provides a lot of early validation, a lot of customer intimacy. It's a great way to build software companies, B2B software companies in particular. Another myth, which we talked about earlier, large traffic translates into large exits. No, it doesn't. Most of the time, it doesn't. In the case of Tumblr, it did, but most of the time, it doesn't. In the case of WhatsApp, it did, but Instagram, it did, but normally, it's very expensive to build traffic, and it's very hard to bootstrap, and even if you have a lot of traffic, it doesn't necessarily mean that it converts into large exits. So, you know, my suggestion to you is self-assess. Self-assess your business. Try to understand, are you fundable or do you need to bootstrap? Some distance all the way, bootstrap first, raise money later. What is the success strategy that you're going to follow? And if you go to our website, there's the 1M1M self-assessment. It steps you through this process of evaluation. Try to answer these questions. If you get stuck in any point, come talk to me and let's help you figure out how to, you know, diagnose and strategize on what should be your funding strategy and what kind of a business are you building. That's pretty much all I want to share with you in terms of, you know, this topic of billion-dollar unicorns and what are the myths, what are the realities. I would be delighted to take questions. If you would like to ask questions in the public chat, please feel free to ask questions on this topic. There's one question from Shreya Saxena, who's asking, what do you think about companies without any revenue model initially, example, Twitter, Quora? Well, there are two different questions. I think Twitter is a very different story than Quora. Twitter actually has a very decent revenue model at this point. The problem that Twitter has today is that it's not scaling, it's not growing fast enough. They've kind of saturated a bit. So the growth is stalling. But when they started, if you look at the time frame when Twitter started, it was a real, you know, renaissance in social media thinking. And at that time, companies were getting funded on this belief that let's just scale, get eyeballs, let's play out this phenomenon, and then we will see how to monetize. And then eventually Twitter did succeed and monetize with advertising revenues. So that, you know, from when Twitter was born, what was the market dynamics at that time and what how they built the company is a specific case. And the same thing happened with WhatsApp, by the way. WhatsApp doesn't monetize yet, but they managed to find an exit, and it was at a time when this whole valuation without revenue financing and all that was game. It was okay in the market. Quora, I think, is a very different story. Quora still monetizes nominally. Quora is founded by the former CTO of Facebook, and there's a lot of money that they have raised. I do think Quora is a pseudo-unicorn. Shreyash is asking if, would you put Quora as a pseudo-unicorn? I believe Quora is a very high-risk company. The chances of this company imploding in the next couple of years is extremely, extraordinarily high. And not only do they not have a revenue model, I don't think they're, you know, they have all these little experiments here and there, but I just don't think this is a very promising company from a revenue point of view, one. And two, they have all kinds of problems. Plagiarism is a huge problem in Quora. People cut and paste stuff from all over the web and just put it on Quora. And this kind of stuff, it's just, you know, anybody looking at Quora as a potential acquisition is going to shy away from acquiring Quora for all those problem reasons. So I do think Quora is a bit of a time bomb. Any other questions? Do you recommend, Shreyash is asking, last question, do you recommend going this way, the way WhatsApp or Twitter scales, since having eyeball business model is quite unappealing for a new online platform or service? No, I do not. I do not think you should go this eyeball building way at all. I don't believe in this strategy of building companies at all. I think it's a very high risk game and the chances of your failing is very, very high. It's the probability of success is incredibly low. Anybody else? Other questions? Chloe writes, you're sending me a message privately. Folks, please send to all participants so that everybody can see your questions. The question is, how successful would an organic beauty business be with no outside funding? We are currently bootstrapping our entire model. Can this be a potential million-dollar company? It can be a potential million-dollar company. It will have to be bootstrapped. There's no question. This is not a, it's not a company that will get funded anytime soon. And you have to, you will be operating with an e-commerce business model, which is bootstrappable. And if you can actually differentiate, and I think it's a tough business actually to, it's a very crowded space, very difficult to differentiate. So even building a million-dollar company is going to be hard, but you will definitely need to bootstrap it, there's no question. All right, folks, I'm going to take a few minutes telling you a bit about 1 million by 1 million, and then I will take more questions, okay? So a quick pointer, there is a lynda.com course that we filmed with LinkedIn. It's called Build It, Don't PowerPoint. It's actually a bootstrapping course. You will, you know, there's a bunch of different modules. There's one called Build It, Don't PowerPoint It, Know the Difference Between a Business Model and Exit Strategy. All these things that we've discussed today, a lot of that is, you know, heavily covered. So if you need to refer to that, please do. It's a very crisp, nice one-hour course. And if you like what we're doing here, please refer 1 million by 1 million to your friends, who are serious entrepreneurs, who know that it takes many years to build good companies. And that's the kind of entrepreneur we are looking to work with, are people who want to stay with an idea and really work through the execution challenges and build serious businesses. All our resources are at 1mby1m.com. You will find a terrific blog on our site, which is free, and if you just follow the blog, you'll learn a lot. And we have the Entrepreneur Journeys book series, which is a series of 12 books that are all case study based, 12 to 16 case studies per book, and each of them delves into a specific topic. Bootstrapping with a paycheck is something we've talked about. Bootstrapping using services is something we've talked about. Each of those are covered in these books with case studies. E-commerce, cloud computing, all of those. Aside from that, there's a ton of material on our website, lots of videos, video FAQs, et cetera. These roundtables happen pretty much every Thursday, so we have a lot more roundtables available this summer. So do sign up if you want to pitch. Today we're not doing a lot of pitches. We're doing Q&A, but we're not doing a lot of pitches, but normally we do you know, entrepreneur pitches and mentoring sessions. So feel free to sign up to pitch or attend and ask questions, and we'll be happy to work with you. These are working sessions, effectively. Go to the free public roundtables page and you can register. In addition, we have the one-on-one and premium program where we offer you extensive methodology guidance. We have an online curriculum that is taught in video lectures and case studies. We help you with business development, strategy consulting, these kinds of roundtables that are private members-only sessions. We also help you with financing if you are fundable, and we will help you diagnose that and define a funding strategy. And then we also have a tremendous clout in the media so we can get the word out about who you are, what you're doing to the audience that you're trying to reach. So that's the $1,000 annual membership fee. You can go to our website, the Million Dollar Club page, and you'll find a lot of examples, case studies of entrepreneurs in the program. The 1M1M value equation ROI analysis is provided on the link that we have as quantifying the 1M1M value equation. We offer $375,000 of cash plus 5 to 10% of equity worth of value for no equity at all, just the $1,000 annual membership fee. You can keep using 1M1M for as long as you need to, year after year, and we'll continue to add value to your process. It's really up to you. We don't have any 3 months. You have to do some this, that, another thing in 3 months. We really don't believe that you can accelerate a company or build a company in 3 months. And we are really interested in building serious companies. I've talked about the self-assessment already. 1M1M basic. So if you are looking for methodology guidance and you want to start somewhere, you know, at a lower price point, $99 a month is our 1M1M basic curriculum only subscription option. You can start there. You can spend a month really deeply studying the curriculum and methodology. You know, if you spend 50 to 100 hours, you're going to have a deep understanding of the methodology, and that would be very helpful. That's pretty much it in terms of, you know, what I want to tell you about 1M1M. Dig around on the website. You'll find tons of information, video FAQs, et cetera. The case studies, by the way, we have over 700 successful entrepreneurs who have participated in the case study program and have brought their perspectives, their journeys, their lessons from the trenches so that you can stand on the shoulders of people who have done it already. This includes over 50 unicorn companies, about 400 venture-funded companies, and around 300 bootstrap success stories. So it's a very comprehensive, you know, body of work that you can learn from. That's pretty much it in terms of what I want to share with you about 1M1M. So I will start taking questions again from the public chat. I see a question from Ilana Ruperti. What is the magic number of customers that a SaaS or PaaS platform as a service company should have before a fundraising campaign? That actually has a lot of different answers. What we're trying to get to these days is, by and large, a 1 million revenue run rate, annual revenue run rate, which equates to a little over 80,000 monthly revenue run rate. So 80,000 MRR, 1 million ARR is roughly where we are. We recommend that you get to before a fundraising campaign. Does that answer your question? Please come and pitch, absolutely. So Maureen, it seems like the slides are lost. There are a few other slides that I was looking for using. Shreya, do you have another question? Absolutely. We're basically doing open Q&A at this point, so anyone can call in. Maureen will give you the call-in numbers in the public chat, and you can call in on by phone as well, and I will take questions from the public chat as well. Shreyash is asking, sorry, I had one more question. How do you feel about social platforms like Facebook, but for specific niche? For example, Airbnb for accommodation. I was more specifically interested in travel sector, where at the moment there is not a good solution. I had seen you had posted that there is a problem of cataloging their travel, so I was curious on your thoughts about this. So, Shreyash, I've written a number of pieces, actually, on things that I would like to see on the, you know, in terms of the travel sector, but my thought actually was not to start a different social media platform, but ways of being able to publish my travelogue on Facebook. Or in some cases, people who use Instagram may want to publish on Instagram. I'm not sure if necessarily you want another social media site for travel or travelers. There have been some attempts. Airbnb obviously has a very particular usage model where you're basically operating with a marketplace of for accommodation. It's a different model. There was another one that you must have encountered, the couch surfing business model. I don't remember the name of the site, but there was this site for couch surfing, et cetera. So there are actually social platforms for specific behavior in the travel sector. Of course, there is a TripAdvisor, which is kind of a social site as well, where you're reviewing and rating and people, the community is learning about your experience and making decisions about where to stay and where to go and where to eat based on your reviews and ratings. Yelp doubles up as a travel sector solution. So there are kind of fragmented pieces out there. The problem with social media platforms, they're very expensive to build. So the question that I will come back to you with, if this is the direction that you want to go, is how are you going to go through, you know, 4 or 5 years of developing this without any external financing? Because I don't think you can get funding for this at this point, at this stage of the game, given where the industry is right now. Does that answer your question, Shreyash? Folks, feel free to call in. The number is on your public chat, 650-479-3208. Access code 666-906-487. Neelu Shukla is asking, what are your thoughts on friends and family funding? You know, that is the only kind of funding that is available in the bootstrap stage, pre-validation stage. So, in the event that you need funding and you have no other option, this is the way to go. And you know, for centuries, that's how people have built businesses. So it's a tried and true method of building businesses. There are, of course, you know, relationship risks, because the thing about startups is they're risky. And, you know, people end up losing money more often than not. So if you think that, you know, that kind of financial risk is going to ruin your relationships with your friends or your family whom you take money from, that is something worth considering. And then there's this other factor with friends and family financing, which is dumb money versus smart money. You know, dumb money can be a pain in the ass. People drive you crazy with questions, requests for updates, why aren't we getting traction, blah, blah, blah. And they don't have any perspective. They don't really understand what's going on in the business often. So having dumb money can be really a nuisance. However, this is the only option in pre-validation financing. Ileana is asking, what are good terms to propose an angel investor? It really depends on where you are, what stage you are. That's too generic a question to answer. The only, you know, somewhat concrete answer pointer I can give you is that do not raise any equity financing at under 2 million pre-money valuation. And if you haven't reached a point where you can justify a $2 million pre-money valuation than raise convertible notes with a valuation cap. Anybody else? Questions, comments, issues? The number is on your screen where you can call right now. 650-479-3208, access code 666-906-487. What is the best strategy for a startup to evaluate themselves? You know, early stage startup valuation is somewhat tricky. So, you know, you're going to have to work with people who know how to do this to guide you and coach you. Shreyas should be calling into the WebEx call. Yes, of course. Ilana, you're asking, do we provide you with valuation guidance and help you negotiate the valuation if you have an angel investment situation going on? Yes, in the premium program, absolutely we will do that. We will guide you through that. Absolutely, no question. So Shreyash, if your question is whether you can call me directly and talk to me, the answer is no. I only work with entrepreneurs through the 1 million by 1 million program, so you should try to understand how 1M1M works and follow the program's guidance on how to work with me. If you're interested in, to call into the discussion, Joy, call in to the line that Maureen is providing. Yeah, so Ilana, if you're, you know, you have access to the private roundtable, so you can pitch at the next private roundtable as well, which is sooner than the next public roundtable. The call does not work. Really? This is how we are called in to this call. That's exactly the number and the access code with which we are dialed into the call. Anybody else? Questions, comments? Ilana, you need to contact Maureen about booking your slot for the pitch session and the private roundtable. There is a section in the private lounge once you log in to with your credentials, premium credentials. There's a section called private roundtables. All the instructions on how to join and call, et cetera, how to schedule a call, all that is provided there. When in doubt, go to the website. We've tried to make it as comprehensive as possible so that you can really work in a self-service mode and with these, you know, interactive sessions to move you along. So when we talk, I will give you a lot of guidance, and I will probably point you to go review a bunch of curriculum modules. So for you, since you are thinking about a lot of financing issues, definitely do the financing module before coming to pitch at the next roundtable. That way we'll have a much more sophisticated conversation. And while you're doing that module, you can also ask questions in the discussion area of those modules, and I'll answer there as well.
Hello, Sramana.
Yes, Shreyas?
I managed to get in the call finally.
Fabulous.
Thanks for the session. I had one more question, which I thought would be interesting to ask through the call. Basically,
sure.
I was interested for the bootstrapping. So occasionally, since we do not raise the money, as interested, like, what would be your advice for, like, having the founding team or how to hire the right employees? Because, like, personally right now means you would see, like, I can't hire, like, web developers or people, or I don't have a co-founder right now who's a web developer. So what would you recommend? Like, some people recommend going to a software solution company which will do this part for you, but personally I don't find this as very comfortable because I feel that the company should have the control of the product entirely. Or do you think we should have consultants or basically?
Shreyash, it's hard for me to advise you without more context. So my recommendation to you is one of two things. One is you can come and pitch at the next public roundtable, mm-hmm. free public roundtable. I would like to understand better what is it that you're building, what is your background, et cetera, and really spend, you know, 10, 15 minutes working on your business with you, and I'll coach you accordingly. And if you're worried about mm-hmm. confidentiality issues or if you want introductions, et cetera, then, you know, you should go join the premium program directly. By the way, there is a whole team building module in the curriculum as well. So if you prefer, mm-hmm. you can also sign up for the 1M1M basic curriculum only option and go to the curriculum and you'll learn from there also. So there are a bunch of different options that you can follow, roundtable, free roundtable, 1M1M basic curriculum only, 1M1M premium, you choose which one.
Okay, thanks.
And folks, all of you, if you would like to talk to someone about what should you do next, in terms of which of the options in 1M1M do you want to follow, feel free to call Irina Patterson. Her email is irina@1mby1m.com. If you could please put that in the public chat, Maureen, that would be great. And Irina would be happy to, you know, listen to you, your situation, and guide you on what is the right solution for you. The most, you know, intense and hands-on way we can help you is in the 1M1M Premium. That's our annual membership program. And that's really comprehensive. But if you're looking for, you know, baby steps of getting into the program, into the community, we are fine with that too. Any other questions? Shreyash, are you all set? Do you have anything else?
No, thanks. I think I'm all set. I think I'll sign up for one-on-one from a particular curriculum. I'm in France right now.
Okay. Is that where you're based?
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. Excellent.
Anybody I'm else? Looking forward for the next sessions and, yeah.
Excellent. Anyone else? Does anybody else have any questions, comments, issues that you want to go over? All right, folks, we are going to adjourn for today then, and we will be back here next week. Premium members who are on the call, you have a private roundtable before the public roundtable next Thursday. So see you in one or the other, whichever one applies to your situation, and good luck with making progress meanwhile. Bye.